Are you here?
Yes.
And now?
Yes.
Because I want to tell you a story. A few weeks back, I was invited to a convocation function. And convocations are all time, occasion for fun, merriment, happiness, sense of completion, fulfillment, name it. And parents, teachers, students are all very happy because they have completed something. But in this convocation, the vice chancellor shocked the audience because he tearfully said that in the last couple of years, they had lost 18 students. The students preferred to end their life rather than complete their course. There were 18 suicides in the university campus. And we hear about suicides of the farmers from the rural part of the country. Suicide for a mental health professional is only tip of the iceberg. The 9-10 portion of the iceberg is invisible. World Health Organization thought of that and came out with a survey which said 25% of the population requires help of a mental health professional. 25% is what? In a family of four, one requires help of a mental health professional. Where do you see this 9-10th portion of the iceberg? Where do you see this 25% of the population? I see them in my clinic, or psychiatrists see them in their clinics, who come with anxiety, depression, dysthymia, dysphoria, obsessive compulsive disorders, schizophrenia, bipolar disorder, borderline personality disorders, sexual dysfunctions. But in the community, you see them everywhere. At the signal, moment the light turns green, they honk. Impatience. At the elevator, they keep on pressing the button again and again and again. And look at their legs. They are so restless. Again, impatience. The students carry heavy bags of laptop and books and heavier burden of high expectations of their parents and the educational loan. The parents are forever afraid that their wards may lose the game of success and achievement. Homemakers are forever searching for time in their multitasking world, few minutes, some space for themselves. The senior citizens feel very, very insecure and isolated. And the adults are running all the time so that at least they'll be at one place. That's a high pressure, high technology, high demand world in which we are living today, which produces this 25%. And for me, this has been my experience for the last 25 or 30 years. And I've gained different kind of insight, just not lost my hair. A few years back, when I was working, I felt different. I felt hollow inside. I was doing my job. I had good reputation. My clients were happy. But I was feeling I'm working mechanically. I'm part of the 25% population. I've become a robo, an efficient robo. I felt very uneasy, out of sorts. And when people feel this way, what advice do we get from people? If you are young, they'll say, get married. If you're married, they'll say, have children. And if you have children and you're married, they'll say, get divorced. But none of them will say that seek a help of a mental health professional. And I did just that. I have no shame, no guilt, no stigma in saying that I sought help of a professor of psychiatry. I sat with him. He listened to me. He got up, hugged me, and said, "You are boss." I said, "What do you mean, sir?" He said, "I see early signs of burnout stress syndrome in you, boss. Time to wake up. All these years you have been minding people's minds. Time to learn. Mind your mind mindfully." Mind is a great word. All centuries, as Homo sapiens, we thought mind is somewhere in the heart. Even the songwriters have not realized that. They always talk about heart. But the mind is a function of the brain. This is the head office of the mind. From this is where it operates, and mind is an operating system. And brain has millions and millions of cells, perhaps more than what you see in the Milky Way. But the stars are not connected with each other, but brain cells are. With very fine axons and dendrons, they're connected with each other, and they're almost talking with each other with neurotransmitters. And it is this network of the cells within the brain that creates, that conjures a concept called self, concept called I, concept called awareness. I, me, myself, I exist. This is myself. But human brain is much more than that. It is not only aware, it is aware that is aware. Awareness of awareness, that's the greatest gift of the human brain. And with that awareness, what do? We dress up, we build structures, we educate, we learn, we relearn, we unlearn, and we discover. So the professor said, "Now discover mindful meditation. So let's do it now." Because I thought I will have to sit down in a posture and do what? So wherever you are, just sit comfortably. Feet firmly on the ground. Experience the firm ground on the floor. Gently close your eyes and focus on your breath. Bring your mind back to the breath. And just breathe in and breathe out. No tension, there is no GST on breath. Breathe in and breathe out. Let your breathe out be longer than the breathe in. And when you do that, you will slowly feel the air that enters your body through your nostrils and goes out of your body through the nostrils. And mind learns to be there on the focus. And that's a very important thing. Because then the mind cuts off the external world, the high tension world, and comes back to the body. So we went on, breathe in and breathe out. Breathe in and breathe out. You can open your eyes. You had a glimpse of mindfulness. What is called now a promo now. A promo of mindfulness. But I'll tell you, and I can assure you, that if you practice for 20 minutes for the next 8 weeks, you will see the change. You'll see the change in your own mind. The way you feel, the way you experience the world, the way you have body sensations, everything will start changing, not in the mind alone, but also in the brain. That is mindfulness. And how does this brain achieve this? This mindfulness is a power, is an empowering experience. And the brain does it with 5 neurotransmitters that I just said. And I fondly call them Sando because they're connected with power. Serotonin, which is with sleep, appetite, sexual lust, and stability. Mindfulness regulates it. Acetylcholine is about neuromuscular function, activity, and curiosity in the brain. Mindfulness regulates that. Norepinephrine, that's a gift of the nature to everyone. That's the first neurotransmitter. It's the first neurotransmitter that comes and pumps your heart in stress. Mindfulness brings it down. D stands for dopamine, which is what? Which is making us happy and feel good. And they've actually found that there is concentration of dopamine much higher in mindful brains. And last but not the least is the oxytocin, the hug hormone that makes you feel I'm connected with the world, the love spreads. So Sando it is for the mindfulness. And who requires Sando? Who requires empowerment? Everyone requires. Every brain requires. It is an education that we have getting into short attention span. Because of social media, you want to check all the time. Everyone. And when you have short attention span, your academic record goes down. And children have low self-esteem, low confidence, and inferiority complex. You practice mindful meditation, it changes. The attention span expands because the brain changes, the cingulate gyrus changes. In illness and health, mindfulness plays a very major role. Because moment you are not feeling nice, uncomfortable, some disorder, somebody makes a diagnosis, and your first question is, why me? Why now? Why here? And friends, that's where the suffering starts. Because we are reacting to the pain. And when you do mindful meditation, there is emotional regulation. And the corporate world, I call it factory, which turns quickly distress into disorders. So we require mindful leaders who are not just passionate, but compassionate. They network, engage people, and lead them mindfully. And in prisoners and jails, there are people who are there essentially because they have not been able to control their impulses. The impulse of greed, anger, anxiety, fear, that's why they land up there. And when I say anger, anxiety, fear, and greed, are we free from that? Only they have acted on it. We just feel it inside. So it's meant for us too. And also for the war veterans who suffer terribly when they come back. They suffer from what is known as post-traumatic stress disorder, PTSD. They're harassed by horrifying experiences of the war. When they're sitting on the front, they see their friends blown up. Terrible traumas. They come back and mindful meditation helps them. Because they learn to distance themselves. They learn to witness rather than participate. And friends, all this is supported by scientific studies with functional MRIs, PET scan, CT scans. This has all been proved scientifically. And mindfulness is not just a feeling, just not a thought. It's not just a concept. It got defined now in a very scientific term as being present moment to moment. Cutting off the past of regret and worry of the future. And mindful meditation is about here and now. It's about acceptance. It is about awareness. It's about clarity. It's about curiosity. And above all, when you get rid of all that junk from the mind, which is called conditioning, you become more creative. You become more innovative. Minding your mind mindfully is a journey, is a way to discover the intuitive wisdom that lies in each one of us. And this is what Buddha believed. There is intuitive wisdom in each one of us. There is joyful self, and we are searching for that joyful self within ourselves. It's deeply buried in the unconscious mind. Mindfulness helps you to build bridges of friendship, compassionate with people around and also with self. With compassion, like charity, begins with self. And last but not the least, mindfulness is about equanimity. Being equanimous in life, with ups and downs of life, you learn to witness and remain mindful. And the most important point of mindfulness is, I feel the joy. I am experiencing the happiness. I am experiencing compassion. Because I am so glad to be with all of you. And all that boss is dead now within me. And I'm very happy that I consulted a psychiatrist. Thank you very much.